way me. You got a high kick, collect and select. You showed you got the best. Crystal ballista, I'm over now. Second game, just a game. Who's a more candy game?
Well, it seems that congratulations are in order. You've made it far enough into the future for them to have announced a sequel to The World Ends With You. Very well done. And I want to talk about this whole Neo shindig for a little while, because this whole situation's kind of interesting. We don't really know that much about the sequel yet. We don't know who's attached to it. We don't know who's directing. We don't know what studio is working on it. Keep in mind that the original game was actually developed in collaboration with Jupiter, the handheld game development studio that helped out on Chain of Memories and stuff like that. Obviously, we have three character designers listed at the end of the trailer, and it's probably safe to assume that Tetsuya Nomura is a producer on this game again. But other than that, unless I've missed anything, I don't think they've said any other staff members who are involved or what division inside of Square Enix is responsible for developing this game. Still a lot we don't know at this point. But The World Ends With You, yeah, I guess we can't call it a franchise now. The World Ends With You franchise, you know, there's a lot of mysteries and things that we don't know, because it seems like at least somebody within Square Enix has been trying to get a sequel to this game off the ground since at least 2012, when the iOS version of the game came out, and it ended with that tease of the girl with the doll in the middle of Scramble Crossing, 7 more days up on the thing, right? Oh, cool, everybody said at the time. Sequel, something gonna happen? Nothing gonna happen. Just a bunch of weirdo nothing teasers related to the franchise for basically the next 8 years. It's important to remember that The World Ends With You is called a cult hit for a reason. I mean, the people that it hit hard. This game has wildly dedicated fans. I knew somebody in college. I'm not sure she'd ever played another video game, but if you got her talking about The World Ends With You, she would just gush about it. But while the game's impact was deep, it wasn't particularly wide. It didn't make much of a splash in Japan at all, and though it did wind up selling decently internationally, it also came out 4 years into the Nintendo DS's lifespan with limited marketing. I mean, sure, it sold over 100,000 units, but that really isn't a lot, especially when you consider other handheld games released by Square Enix in the same year. The World Ends With You released in the same year as Tactics A2, the DS version of Final Fantasy IV, the DS version of Dragon Quest V, and freaking Crisis Core Final Fantasy VII. The World Ends With You got its clock cleaned by other games from the same company. A2 sold more than twice as many units as The World Ends With You, Crisis Core Lifetime cleared 3 million units, and Dragon Quest V, predictably, sold more than 1 million units in Japan alone. So sure, someone within Square has been trying to get a sequel off the ground, but it isn't really stunning to me that it took so long for it to happen. First question is always, who's gonna make it? If every development team inside Square is occupied with games that are expected to sell better than a sequel to TwiiWii, then no one's gonna make it. Do you then contract it out to another company? I mean, the next question after that is, where do you even put it? On the 3DS? iOS? How much money do you want to spend on it? What audience is it even for? And all these questions probably just got harder to answer as more time passed, the handheld market slowly evaporated, and development costs increased across the board. Historically speaking, Square as a company really prioritizes high-end visuals and production values. Better-looking games require bigger budgets require higher sales to return a profit, so it makes sense to me that the prospect of a sequel to The World Ends With You wouldn't have been the most popular idea internally. I can't seem to find good lifetime sales numbers on the iOS or Switch versions of The World Ends With You, but I'm sure that they would have had some impact on the perceived commercial viability of a sequel. Personally, though, I think there may be another factor worth considering in the revival of this series. Now, hold on, don't turn off the video. Don't turn off the video. Let me explain myself first. I want to talk about Persona. No, stop, don't go anywhere. I want to talk about sales and production values, okay? For whatever reason, people got into a pissing match on Twitter after Neo was announced, because I guess some Persona 5 fans were saying that it looked like Persona 5, what with the stylized Shibuya, and then TwiiWii fans got their knickers in a twist because TwiiWii did it first. But as with a lot of Twitter trends, I never actually saw anyone making the initial Persona 5 comparison, only people getting mad at the fact that the comparison was being made without linking to an example of the comparison being made. So I can only assume that one one troll said something that happened to get some attention, and then he spent the rest of the day patting himself on the back for a job well done, like always happens with Twitter. But anyway, the reason I want to talk about Persona is because of the financial success the series has had recently and the way that Square Enix seems to be changing their tune on certain things. Squaresoft was a successful video game company before the PlayStation era, but it's important to remember just how much their fortunes improved in the PlayStation era. Certainly the Final Fantasy series had fans internationally, but FF6 didn't sell well enough in the US to be considered a commercial success outside of Japan. In the PlayStation era, Squaresoft achieved a kind of meteoric rise to international dominance and power, and it was largely off the back of the technical impressiveness of their games. Certainly, if you talk to anybody who's a big fan of the PlayStation era works of Squaresoft, they're gonna gush about the stories, the world, the music, the art direction, yada yada yada. But the fact of the matter is the games had to be sold in the first place, and the visual fidelity of those games did a lot of that selling at the time. Sporting fantabulous graphics and production values has become kind of a staple of everything the company touches ever since, with some staffers going so far as to say that graphics and technology are one of the pillars of the Final Fantasy franchise. Even though I'm not really sure they've been a major contributor to the success of any of their projects since maybe the PS2 era. I don't know, that's just how I see it, at least. I mean, you know, it makes some degree of sense. They're chasing after the model that made them really super-duper ludicrously successful in the late 90s and early 2000s. It's just that sometimes they seem so married to this image, this crystallized image, if you will, of their success at one point in time that they can't seem to unentangle themselves from it, even when it's not beneficial. Like, I mean, I think about their attempts to do more quotation marks budget games, where you get something like Lightning Returns, right, where all the main characters still look like they're in this ludicrously expensive video game, but then the dogs look like this. Which is why when I saw people complaining that the graphics in the Final Fantasy 16 trailer look a little undercooked, the only thing I wanted to say to those people was, you're the reason we can't have nice things! The fact that this trailer for an unfinished video game looks like a slightly unfinished version of the Final Fantasy VII remake is everything that I could hope for. What is wrong with you? I've talked about this type of thing before in other videos, and this is obviously not a Square Enix exclusive problem. This affects a lot of people in the video games industry, but since we're here talking about this, I am zeroing in on Square a little bit right now. Obviously, there were exceptional circumstances surrounding Final Fantasy XV, but the 5 million units sold in the first 24 hours weren't touted as a major financial success, but instead as a sigh of relief because it meant that the game had broken even. And now the Avengers game is apparently becoming a financial headache for the company. It was the best-selling game of the month it released in, the second best-selling superhero game launch of all time behind Spider-Man PS4, and apparently it has failed to even recoup its development costs yet. Meanwhile, Persona 5, which is about 3 times longer than Final Fantasy 15, by the way, only sold about 2 million units in its first 2 years, and it was cited as a major contributor to an increase in annual revenue for Sega. I'm bringing this up because, you know, I'm just saying, if you're a bean counter businessman and you're making all these huge budget games and sweating bullets every time they go on sale, these kinds of numbers are impossible to ignore. These guys sold 5 million units in 24 hours and they were terrified about the future of their franchise. Meanwhile, Atlus and Persona, a studio and series they probably barely even consider competitors, celebrated the financial success of a game that, after 4 years and a re-release, has only sold 4.6 million units, not even catching up to FF15's day one sales. And as I move on with this conversation and I link it back around to The World Ends With You, it's key to note that this is a pretty new thing for the Persona series. Because Personas 3 and 4 came out really late in the PlayStation 2's life cycle, well after most folks had moved on to the next generation of hardware. Persona 4 didn't even crack 500,000 units in Japan, and in the US it barely cracked 100,000. The Persona series was, you could perhaps say, a cult hit that made a deep impact, but not a particularly wide one. I consider myself to be a pretty savvy, in-the-know gamer man, but I think the only times I ever even heard the title Persona uttered before 2011 were an old extra credits video talking about sexual representation in video games, and one video where Noah Antweiler called Persona 4 the best console RPG of all time. And the reason I specify before 2011 is because that's when the series had kind of this weird spike in public prominence. A wildly popular anime adaptation of Persona 4 was released. Huh? And the series suddenly had a presence at E3, showing off a really cool-looking fighting game and what would wind up being the only game on the PlayStation Vita that mattered. Atlus then managed to surf the sudden international interest of the series over the next few years, releasing more spin-off games and other types of things, cultivating and nurturing the franchise as it slowly went from cult sensation to big deal, which is how you get to Persona 4 Golden selling almost as many units on Steam in a month as it did across both versions in Japan over 6 years. It didn't exactly happen overnight, but they managed to take these relatively small cult hit games that were starving for an audience and turn them into much larger financial successes. And all of this is why, when I see people looking at the trailer for Neo: The World Ends With You and complaining that jaggies and low detail environments are unacceptable in a Square Enix game from 2021, I say to those people, you're the reason we can't have nice things! I can't help but look at this 7 More Days tease from all the way back in 2012 and ask, why didn't it happen then? Clearly somebody was trying to make it happen, they just couldn't get it off the ground. So what's changed since then? I ask myself, did the Nintendo Switch version just sell a lot better than the iOS version or something? I mean, of course, duh, right? Of course the Nintendo Switch version probably sold better than the freaking iOS version. But my point is then, you know, they would know that too. They would know that a Switch version would sell better than the iOS version. So it can't just be that this one sold more units than the last, you know, re-release did. Could another factor be that in the meantime, Atlus managed to take a backwater cult series and turn it into a reasonably budgeted mainstream competitor, one that can sell half the units of Square Enix's usual fare and still be considered a winner? It really has seemed like, for the longest time, Square has been laboring under the assumption that if their games weren't the most cutting edge, weren't the most high end, there simply wasn't room for them as part of the company's overall brand, and the idea of somehow slotting The World Ends With You into that brand wasn't a puzzle anyone wanted to spend the money to solve. I mean, honestly, really, sit down, go inside of your mind palace for a second, ask yourself this, okay? Before watching the trailer for Neo, would you have ever imagined Square Enix releasing a major game with low detail character models and talking head portraits on a console in the year 2021? They're actively making Bravely Default 2 look ugly because of their refusal to do exactly that. Akihiko Yoshida's character designs and art style are absolutely perfect for that style of presentation, and the only game they ever did it in with his characters was Tactics. I can't stand it. But look at what they're doing now with this The World Ends With You sequel. Persona 5 came out about 4 years ago, which sounds to me like just enough time for it to be out for a little bit, sell really well internationally, and win a bunch of awards, for whoever the relevant people within Square Enix were to dust off their sequel pitch, to convince whoever they needed to convince that the game could make money if they produced it the right way, to convince Tetsuya Nomura that he had the time to work on a 16th project, and to pull the team and resources together, in time to finish the whole thing up in summer of 2021. They cranked out that Switch version and actually bothered to, you know, market it to try and introduce people to the series, and then probably turned around and pumped the profits of it right back into the development of the sequel. And check it out, they're even releasing an anime characterizing the sequel game as a follow-up to this new anime, so you don't even need to have played the original game to get into the sequel. I'm sure that this is both a bid to get lapsed fans of the game back on the hype train, and also maybe to win over some Japanese fans since the game was really a bigger deal internationally. They're basically just doing a super compressed version of what Atlus wound up doing, intentionally or not, from 2011 up to the release of Persona 5. And to be clear, when I say intentionally or not, I mean what Atlus did with Persona. Clearly what's happening here with The World Ends With You is extremely calculated. Of course, if this means that we're gonna get a bunch of really bad The World Ends With You dancing games, then in that instance, I'm gonna be looking at Atlus and saying, you're the reason we can't! And on that note, I don't wanna sound like I'm talking about all this just because I'm a fan of the Persona series. Like, if I saw a model in the Madden NFL series that I thought somehow influenced the arrival of a The World Ends With You sequel at this particular moment in time, then I'd be talking about that. It's not about me really liking Persona or whatever, it's just that I'm really looking at this and going, okay, if they were having trouble getting the game off the ground before now, what could have changed at this point? And I really feel like that if the problem was the money, if the problem was, well, we don't know how to make a big budget AAA game for The World Ends With You, and it didn't sell well enough before, if someone was able to walk in and say, no, look, they did this. They already did this because the sales, because we were kind of in a similar situation with the original The World Ends With You to where Persona used to be, and now Persona's here. So maybe we can get here. Man, I'm just so happy about this whole situation. I mean, obviously I'm happy that The World Ends With You is finally getting a sequel, but I'm happy about the whole big picture, holistic experience here, man. If this thing is, you know, if this thing is actually modestly budgeted, if Square Enix is releasing a modestly budgeted and stylized big game on consoles, and it winds up selling well, that's obviously one big thing, but they announce it in the same week that they announce they're gonna let people keep working remotely even after the pandemic is over. It's just back-to-back boom positivity blasts from Square Enix. Final Fantasy 16 looks like it's gonna be cool. I love the FF7 remake. They're doing pretty well right now, in my book at least. I really hope Neo The World Ends With You winds up being fantastic and selling super duper well, because I mean, this could be the inroad, guys. This could be the point where the numbers come in and they go, oh, we can make a lower budget stylized Final Fantasy, or even like a throwback one with a, you know, a really nice pixel art style or whatever, right? And that could really do well and be awesome. This could be an inroad to all kinds of other stuff. I'm very, I'm pleased with these developments. We obviously got to see where it goes. I like all of the dominoes that have been set up here. Who knows what shape they'll fall into, but so far, yeah, it's looking okay. Speaking of, though, Square Enix, hi, hello. Good job, by the way, on the announcement and release window on this bad boy here. I know, obviously, I've made jokes in the past about, like, you know, announcing games, you know, days before they come out, and obviously, I know that's not viable. You need time to, you know, market things, to get people excited for a product, to build anticipation, obviously. But, you know, the time period you've set up here for The World Ends With You, Neo, to release, you know, it's a nice window. You didn't announce it 6 years in advance, you know? I appreciate it. And I want to be very clear. Take your time with Final Fantasy VII Remake Part 2. I don't need to see trailers or anything like that. Take your time, just develop the game, focus on making it. You don't need to derail production to show me a trailer for a thing that won't be out for several years. It's fine, it's totally fine. That being said, though, could we just get one picture of Remake Yuffie? Just like a concept art or like a render, just a little bit, just so I know she's alive and okay. Just a tiny JPEG of Yuffie. Could we just get one little Yuffie JPEG? I would settle for a Sid Highwind JPEG, honestly. So just a little song.